Shalom. Today we are continuing in a new series, What's in a Name? And we will talk about the name of Abraham, in Hebrew, Avraham. Remember, there are, it may be, so many kinds of voices in the world, and none of them is without signification. Everything that is spoken has significance. We first meet Abraham in Genesis 11:26, and Terach, his father, lived 70 years and begat Abram, Nahor, and Haran. So initially his name was Avram or Abram. This name Avram can easily be broken up into two pieces. The first half is Av, and it means father. We see from the paleo letters that the Aleph is the strong one and the Bet is the house. So the father should be the strength of the house. Genesis 2:24. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. The second part of his name is Ram, Resh Mem. The Resh is for the head, and the Mem is for the water. So this is a person who's higher up than other people. Sometimes the water refers to people. We'll see that in a minute. He's exalted up, he's lifted up above the water and above the other people. Genesis 7:17. And the flood was 40 days upon the earth, and the waters increased, and bare up the ark, and it was lifted up above the earth. This is the same root, Ram. It seems kind of a cruel joke to name somebody exalted father when they have no children, but Abram was the head of his unit, his tribal unit, and we see that he was exalted in at least in worldly goods in Genesis 13:2. And Abram was very rich in cattle, in silver, and in gold. And when Lot was taken, Abram sent his servants off to go fight against the kings and retrieve Lot, Genesis 14:14. And when Abram heard that his brother was taken captive, he armed his trained servants born in his own house, 318, and pursued them unto Dan. He has these 318 strong men in the prime of their life that are able to fight. So we can assume that they also have children and they also have wives and grandfathers. So he has a lot of servants. He's quite wealthy in the things of this world. Now in the course of time, God is going to change his name. In Genesis 17:4-5. As for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations. Neither shall thy name any more be called Abram, but thy name shall be called Abraham. For the father of many nations have I made thee. The word many there is hamon, and it comes from a root, hama. And this root is actually even an English cognate to the word hum. So we have the picture of many people making a kind of humming noise or enough noise that we know that there's a lot of people there. In Isaiah 17:12, we see both of these words used in the same verse. Woe to the multitude, hamon, of many people, which make a noise, hama, like the noise, hama, of the seas, and to the rushing of nations, that make a rushing like the rushing of mighty waters. So we can just imagine a lot of people gathered together, the sound of what that would sound like. Again, we see in Revelation 19:6, and I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of mighty thunderings, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. So God squeezed this hamon idea into Avram's name, and his name became Avraham. From another point of view, we can see Yehovah, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, took a He out of his own name and gave it to Avraham. Sometimes the letter He is seen as a breath, so perhaps he breathed into Avraham and brought life to him. If you want to know more about the other letters of Yahweh's name, you can check out this video, Yahweh Gives Up His Name, on this channel. So what is the context of why God changes Abraham's name? In Genesis 17:2, And I will make my covenant between me and thee, and will multiply thee exceedingly. In Genesis 17:10-11, this is my covenant which ye shall keep between me and you and thy seed after thee. Every man-child among you shall be circumcised, and ye shall circumcise the flesh of your foreskin, and it shall be a token of the covenant betwixt me and you. It's quite interesting that Sarah is not able to become pregnant until after Abraham is circumcised. The circumcision doesn't make the covenant. The circumcision is the sign of the covenant. We need to remember that our flesh bears the mark. It is a token of the covenant. It is not the covenant. We know that in other cases, when people have a covenant between them, that they exchange things. For example, in 1 Samuel 18:4, Jonathan stripped himself of the robe that was upon him and gave it to David. In his garments, even to his sword and to his bow and to his girdle. So there was an exchange of physical goods. In this case, Abraham got a hay. He got a breath of life out of Jehovah, and he gave up a little tiny piece of skin. So where are these multitudes that are promised to Abraham? Should we look among today's modern Jews to find these multitudes? Sometimes it is said among traditional Jews that Abraham was the first Jew. This is obviously an oxymoron because the Jews are named for the tribe of Judah. Judah is four generations away, ahead in time from Abraham. So Abraham cannot actually be a Jew. And even the rabbinical writings confirm that this is not a fact. We see in Sanhedrin 59b, Abraham and his descendants until Sinai are also accounted sons of Noah. Those who departed from Egypt as heathens and received the Torah on Mount Sinai when they were, so to speak, converted to Judaism. And that's from a footnote in Yevamot 46a. So who was Abraham? Genesis 14:13. And there came one that escaped and told Abram the Hebrew, for he dwelt in the plain of Mamre, the Amorite, brother of Eshcol, and brother of Aner, and these were confederate with Abram. So we see that Abraham was a Hebrew. Looking at his genealogy, in Genesis 10:21, unto Shem, who was one of the sons of Noah, the father of all the children of Eber, the brother of Japhet, the elder, even to him were children born. So it's interesting because from Adam to Noah is 10 generations, and then picking up from Shem until Abraham is also 10 generations. But here, the writer picked out from Shem, he skips a few generations, and he brings out the fact that these are the children of Eber. It's an important person in the lineage. So in 1 Chronicles 1:24-27, we see the entire lineage. Shem, Arpachshad, Shelach, Eber, Peleg, Reu, Serug, Nahor, Terach, Abram, the same is Abraham. So these are signposts in the midst of those generations, Shem, Eber, and Abraham. The name Eber comes from this root avar, which means to cross over or to pass by. In Genesis 32:10, it is used, I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies and of all the truth which you have shown your servant, for I crossed over this Jordan with my staff, and now I have become two companies. Interesting, after he crosses over, he becomes two groups of people. Exodus 12:23, for Yahweh will pass through to strike the Egyptians, and when he sees the blood on the lintel and on the two doorposts, Yahweh will pass over the door, and not allow the destroyer to come into your houses to strike you. So we see here comes Abraham. He comes out of Ur of the Chaldees, and eventually he crosses over and he comes into the land of Canaan. He also crosses away from those countries and their idol worship, and he crosses over into worship of the one true God. There's another place where it talks about the multitude of nations when Jacob is blessing Joseph's sons, Ephraim and Manasseh. And you remember that he crossed his hands and he laid the greater blessing, his right hand, on Ephraim's head. in Genesis 48:19. And his father refused and said, I know it, my son, I know it. He also shall become a people, and he also shall be great. But truly his younger brother shall be greater than he, and his seed shall become the multitude of nations. The Hebrew there is melo hagoyim, and it's translated into the Greek as plethos ethnon. If you want to know more about who the goyim are, there is a video you can watch here, who are the Gentiles. The point is that it's the nations. It's a multitude of nations translated in English. But even in the Greek and the Hebrew, it means the fullness of the Gentiles and or the fullness of the nations. You know where you've heard that before. Paul quotes it in Romans. Romans 11:25. For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part has happened to Israel, until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. Again, a related phrase in Greek, to pyroma ton ethnon. Ethnon is, it means nations, it is people groups. We're looking for the multitudes that come from Abraham. Remember, the blessing is going to Ephraim, Joseph's son, who is, again, four generations after Abraham. So God found some special things about Abraham, undoubtedly part of the reason that he made this covenant with him. In Genesis 17:9, and God said unto Abraham, thou shalt keep to my covenant, therefore, thou and thy seed after thee in thy generations. It's about covenant keeping. In Genesis 18:19, for I know him, that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of Yahweh to do justice and judgment, that Yahweh may bring upon Abraham that which he hath spoken of him. And again, in Genesis 26:5, because that Abraham obeyed my voice and kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my laws. This is not a bunch of miscellaneous words here concerning the word of God. In Hebrew, you have the mishmar, the charge of things that he's given to guard over, the mitzvot, the commandments, the things that God commands him to do, the chukot, which are the statutes, things which literally are engraved in stone, and the Torah, all the teachings and instruction. It is common in modern traditional Judaism that converts to Judaism will take a Hebrew name. And you know the Hebrew names generally are the name who is the son of so-and-so. So if we talk about Isaac, it's going to be Yitzchak ben Avraham. He's the son of Abraham. If it's Jacob, it's going to be Yaakov ben Yitzchak. In modern Jewish culture, any child is born and given a name in the local language, but also gets a Hebrew name, and that child will be that child's name in Hebrew, ben or bat, and then the father's name will appear. But for converts to Judaism, they do not have a choice for their father, and they may not use their father's name. Instead, they are always given the name Ben Avraham or Bat Sarah. This is because Abraham and Sarah are considered to be the forebearers of Judaism. Listen what Isaiah says, Isaiah 51:1-2. Hearken to me, ye that follow after righteousness, ye that seek Yahweh, look unto the rock whence ye are hewn, and to the hole of the pit whence ye are digged. Look unto Abraham your father, and unto Sarah that bare you. For I called him alone, and blessed him, and increased him. So this is a biblical thought that the believers come from the line and from the spiritual heritage of Abraham. Reading in Romans 4, verse 3. For what saith the scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. In verse 16, therefore it is of faith, that it might be by grace, to the end the promise might be sure to all seed, not to only which is of the law, but to also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. And in verses 23 and 24, Now, it was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him, but for us also, to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Yeshua, our Lord, from the dead. Finally, Paul writes in Galatians 3:29, And if ye be Messiahs, then are ye Abraham's seed, and heirs according to the promise. As we look around, we see the multitudes that are given to Abraham by faith. It is all those who belong to Messiah. Next time, we will go on to another name. In the meantime, Tasim et ha'inayim al hashamayim. Keep your eye on the sky. Your redemption draweth nigh. Shalom.